Good evening. We are glad you all joined us this evening for worship. My name is Susan Boxberger, and my husband Harold and I are here serving as volunteers with Wittenberg English Ministry, which has been providing English language services here in Wittenberg for the last 26 years. We are blessed to have with us this evening Reverend Greg Wilson. She's been with us for the last 2 weeks, and we're sad to say this is her last service with us. We are also very fortunate to have a last-minute fill-in organist this evening, Dr. Stephen Hoffman. It's from Wyoming in the U.S., and we will enjoy his playing as well. There is a place later in the service for us to take an offering. Wittenberg English Ministry is a volunteer organization, and so we don't receive any funding from any particular branch of Lutheranism, and we depend on the goodwill of folks like you to keep our ministry going. We're glad you're here.
Welcome in the name of the Lord. As Susan shared, I'm the Reverend Brett Wilson. I bring greetings on behalf of the congregation I serve, which is Georgetown Lutheran Church in Washington, D.C. It's a joy to be in worship together tonight, and I invite you to participate as fully as you feel called. You have everything you need in the bulletin there. I invite you to sing, to respond with the words printed in bold, and to share in our prayers together, knowing that God is here with us. So with that, I invite you to stand as you're able as we begin our worship with our opening hymn.
Thank you.
worship as we live, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Lord, you descended into the mire of this world to raise us up. Enable us to descend as you descended, that we might rise with you to the beloved community of your resurrected life. Amen. You may be seated.
First scripture reading from Isaiah chapter 47, verses 10 to 15. You felt secure in your wickedness. You said, "No one sees me." Your wisdom and your knowledge led you astray. And you said in your heart, "I am, and there is no one besides me." But evil shall come upon you, which you cannot charm away. Disaster shall fall upon you, which you will not be able to ward off. And ruin shall come on you suddenly, of which you know nothing. Stand fast in your enchantments and your many sorceries with which you have labored from your youth. Perhaps you may be able to succeed. Perhaps you may inspire terror. You are wearied with your many consultations. Let those who study the heavens stand up and save you. Those who gaze at the stars and at each new moon predict what shall befall you. See, they are like a stubble. A fire consumes them. They cannot deliver themselves from the power of the flame. No coal for warming oneself is this, no fire to sit before. Such to you are those with whom you have labored, who have trafficked with you from your youth. They all wander about in their own paths. There is no one to save.
Psalm 91, verse 9 through 16. Because you have made the Lord your refuge and the Most High your habitation, no evil will befall you, nor shall affliction come near your dwelling. For God will give the angels charge over you, to charge you in all ways. Upon their hands they will bear you up, lest you strike your foot against a stone. You will tread upon the lion covered by them. You will trample down the lion and the serpent. I will deliver those who cling to me. I will uphold them because they know my name. They will call me and I will answer them. I will be with them in trouble. I will rescue and honor them. With long life will I satisfy them and show them my salvation.
Please rise for the reading of the Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to Luke, the 22nd chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. A dispute arose among them as to which of them was to be regarded as the greatest. But Jesus said to them, "The kings of the Gentiles lord it over them, and those in authority over them are called benefactors. But not so with you. Rather, the greatest among you must become the youngest, and the leader like one who serves. For who is greater, the one who is at the table or the one who serves? Is it not the one who is at the table? But I am among you as one who serves. You are those who stood by me in my trials, and I confer on you, just as my Father has conferred on me, a kingdom, so that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom, and you will sit on thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. One of my favorite poems about ministry is written by William Croswell Doane, and it's called The Preacher's Mistake. And it goes like this: "The parish priest of high austerity climbed high up in a church to be nearer to God, so that he might hand his word down to his people. When the sun was high, when the sun was low, the good preacher sat unheeding any earthly things, and instead, only from transcendency was he forever reading. And now and again, when he heard the creak of the old weather vane a-turning, he closed his eyes and said, 'Ah, of a truth from God, now I am learning.' And in sermon's script, he daily wrote what he thought was sent down from heaven, and he dropped this down on people's heads twice, one day in seven. In the preacher's old age, God said, 'Come down and die.' And he cried out, 'Where art thou, Lord?' And the Lord replied, 'Down here among my people.' Down here among my people. Where God has always been." So you might be curious, as I was, does it look different from up here in this high pulpit? Not really. I noticed this last week also at the Stadtkirche up in its high pulpit, but really, it doesn't change too much. But I still just see the faces of you, real people, who need to hear God's good news, just like me. Jesus reminds us the greatest among you must become like the youngest and the leader like the one who serves. Reformations often happen when the voices of those in need are heard and their plight is amplified and noticed. Sometimes reformations come from this pastoral concern for the people. Now, Luther and Melanchthon did undertake a theological and academic discourse and understanding when they started all their writing 500 years ago. But it was also deeply pastoral, with a heart for the people and their struggles. They knew the people here in town. Both Luther and Melanchthon had boarders and students who stayed at their house and made a whole community, in addition to their families for whom they were responsible. As the clergy of Wittenberg, including Luther, baptized people right here, presided at the burials, stood before this altar to marry and to share from the table, I imagine that they saw the people's real faces, just like we see each other's now, and that they experienced a deep care for each other. And when we actually read the 95 Theses, it highlights that this is not simply an academic takedown or arguing over theological minutiae, nor is it the pitched flag of a conqueror, like, ha, I've done it. Reading the Theses, as well as the further works of the reformers, we see that at its heart it is down here among God's people, with a care for them. Perhaps Luther and the Wittenberg clergy, just as I have quite often as pastor, been entrusted to listen to people's deep concerns about their souls, about whether or not they're really forgiven, about struggling to believe that God could really love them. Luther must have known this fear that people feel, and he references it in Thesis 15, and he says, this fear that people feel is punishment enough. They do not need the fear of purgatory or the punishment of the church. That fear has an inverse relationship to love, is a thread among the Theses, and that fear does not convey God's love. Thesis 31 acknowledges this very human struggle when Luther writes, no one is sure of the integrity of their own contrition. Whew, that's some honesty that Luther puts out there, that we all aren't sure how faithful we are when we confess to God, that I'm not sure I'm faithful enough, good enough, confess my sins well enough. Well, good news, spoiler, you don't have to be. It's not up to you. And it is God's free grace, gift of grace through Christ, not our own doing. It's not as if your imperfection or mine could weaken God's power to love you. Thesis 36 boldly reads, any truly repentant Christian has a right to full remission of penalty and guilt, without any indulgence letters. This centers that heart for the people, that everybody has the right to know that they are truly forgiven and loved by God. In today's scriptures, particularly that Isaiah text, there's some frightening language that indeed confronts us with our individual sin and humanity's collective brokenness. This is the law that tells us the truth and shows us our deep need for a loving, saving God, not based on our merit, but on God's grace. But here, this passage in Luke from the Gospel, it is around the table at the Last Supper. Jesus has just broken bread with them, and yet there they are squabbling about, okay, cool, but which one of us is the best? But Jesus then reminds them that everything will be reversed. That theology of the cross, that it won't be what you call great, but you will find God in the last place you'd expect. But then, even after all of that, Jesus says to them in verse 29 there, he says, I confer on you a kingdom. after Jesus has seen up close all of our mess, still the gift of grace. It reminds me of one of my favorite verses from earlier in Luke, where Jesus says, "Do not be afraid, little flock, for it is the Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom." This is the pastoral heart of the Reformation and the good news that we have to share today. This is grace. We see and experience God's heart that will tell us the truth about where we fall short and still love you completely, forgive you completely, and hold you no matter what. Calls you God's own and gives you even the kingdom. Want to find God? Jesus said, "I am among you as one who serves." Who exemplifies that for you? Service down there among God's people. Earlier today, this church was filled with 600 people, replete with choirs and others, to have a memorial service for Pastor and Professor Frederick Schorlemmer. He was a teacher in the preacher school here in Wittenberg and a powerful leader who believed and taught the focus of theology for others. And thus it meant that it didn't stay confined to just within the church walls. Based on a deeply rooted faith, his memorial note says, he became involved in the city society and far beyond it. He held discussion groups, environmental groups, and also got involved in politics. He was a committed pacifist, but he challenged violence in lots of different ways by leading prayers for renewal before and through the process of reunification in 1989. He was down among God's people. What reformations are being born today? Because people hear the cries of others in need and know that change is going to come. The good news is here. Where are you, God? Down there, among God's people, with you. Thanks be to God. Amen. I invite you to stand as we join in singing together.
Thank you.
Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. We pause in our worship to receive an offering for the support of this ministry and as a time of reflection as we give thanks to God.
Abundant harvest that all may share, and for peaceful time,
Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For public servants, the government, and those who protect us, for those who work to bring peace, justice, healing, and protection in this and every place, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For those who travel, for those who are sick and suffering, and for those who are in captivity, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For deliverance in the time of affliction, wrath, danger, and need, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For all servants of the church, for this assembly, and for all people who await from the Lord great and abundant mercy, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Giving thanks for all who have gone before us and are at rest, rejoicing in the communion of all the saints, we commend ourselves, one another, and our whole lives to you, through Christ our Lord, to you, O Lord. O God, you have called your servants to ventures of which we cannot see the ending, by paths as yet untrodden, through perils unknown. Give us faith to go out with good courage, not knowing where we go, but only that your hand is leading us and your love supporting us. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We pray with confidence as Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. May the peace of Christ be with you always.